Hi everyone, I'm Gary Null, broadcasting and video streaming live from our studios in New York City, and I'd like to welcome you to what should be a very engaging program. We're going to begin with a component in ginseng is found to have anti-tumor effects against liver cancers. Texas Tech University is sharing that, and we have a lot more. I'm going to do a rather quicker and shorter impact upon our good nutrition today because I'm going to give more room for our guest. We're going to talk about G5 today. She's just returned from China. She's one of the world's leading experts on the subject. She'll be with us live in that segment. Plus today, I have one of three in original reports on Wikipedia, completely different than anything we've done in the past. I think you'll find this of interest because the question is, what kind of person would attack someone like Deepak Chopra or Andrew Weil or Rupert Sheldrake or all the hundreds of people who have given us so much, have made the world a better place, have done so with thoughtfulness? Why would you want to destroy their reputations? What kind of person does that? A sociopath? A narcissist? An egomaniac? We're going to address that, the mental health of many of the editors on Wikipedia. And then tomorrow, I'm going to do a really scorching challenge to Wikipedia and its 100,000 editors. In my personal opinion, you're a fraud. You do not represent an encyclopedia. I'll make my case in documents comparing Encyclopedia Britannica and seven other legitimate encyclopedias with Wikipedia, and yet Wikipedia dwarfs all of them. What does that say about we as a people and our government and the media and our universities and physicians? That will be discussed tomorrow. Also, time permitting today, I'll play at least a short part of a very important documentary done by the BBC on the dangers of Wi-Fi and 5G currently in Great Britain. None of this information is being disseminated in the United States. So that's our program. We have a lot to share. We begin with ginseng. Now, ginseng has got a lot of good science behind it. Here's the interesting part. Wikipedia tells you everything about Chinese and Oriental medicine is just nonsense, pseudoscience, quackery. Yeah. Really? Just ginseng alone was the topic of a national debate that I was invited to participate in back in the 1970s. When we went on the air, and this was on ABC, Alice Fennell was producing, and the doctor said, well, there's really no science behind it. I just happened to have brought a gigantic folder. Now, if you're watching right now, it literally was a foot thick, and it had 5,000 scientific articles on the power of ginseng. And that was just from China. I didn't even look at the scientific literature in South Korea and in Japan that also has used it for a long time. The reality is ginseng has been linked to improvements in liver function and the treatment of liver disorders, especially if you have a toxic liver from drinking or from medications or drugs. If you have hepatitis or liver fibrosis or cirrhosis or hepatocellular carcinoma or liver cancer. So, one more piece to our healing puzzle, one type of what is called ginsenoside, and it is particularly effective against liver cancer. Now, liver cancer is extremely bad. Yeah, there's not a lot of hope for a lot of people with it. But this ginseng compound inhibits not only the invasion of cancer cells, but also their migration and growth to other sites, a process we call metastasis. And the biological activities and therapeutic benefits of ginseng are attributed mainly to a class of plant compounds called saponins, S-A-P-O-N-I-N-S. And saponins are active phytochemicals, often found in fruits and vegetables like peas and soybeans, as well as different herbs. Now, saponins are known to have antioxidant properties. They reduce bone loss. They lower blood cholesterol. They lower the risk of cancer. They boost your immunity. So ginseng exerts an extremely beneficial effect of reducing the expression of the enzymes that promote cancer cell metastasis by degrading the extracellular matrix. And this degradation facilitates angiogenesis, that angio, A-N-G-I-O, genesis, G-E-N-E-S-I-S. That's the formation of new blood cells and tumor invasion. So that's how it works. Also up, and this is important because people over 50 who attend religious services and pray privately can notice better memory performance. Wow, that's right, private prayer, and you could also say private meditation, can boost your memory for adults, especially if you're over 50. That's according to a study's finding, and I think that that's good. And they took a look at specifically private prayer among blacks, Hispanics, and whites, and those who prayed privately benefited in their cognition. This was from the University of Michigan Health and Retirement Study. So 16,000 people were in this study. So that's important. So if you have that moment where you want to go into deep meditation and confer your thoughts, your hopes, your dreams, your concerns to the universe and to whatever ultimately you believe in, it shows it works. And something else that works, Ohio State University shows that drinking green tea can help you if you have leaky gut syndrome. The findings of a recent study also suggest that the consumption of green tea not only helps prevent obesity, but also improves gut health to reduce leaky gut. That's a big deal because we have tens of millions of Americans, because of their high protein and high fat diet, they have terrible bacteria in the gut, generally harmful bacteria, yeast overgrowth. And by changing around, drinking green tea, you can help rebalance this. And so that's important. Also, yoga and meditation improve mind-body health and stress resilience. Who says? University of Southern California. This was published in the peer-reviewed journal Frontiers in Human Neuroscience. Now, why is this important? Because once again, the skeptics, the people who control the 700 different pages on Wikipedia involving all health, they don't believe in yoga and meditation improving anything. Oh, anything that happens, it's just a placebo effect. Really? I never will forget the first time that I helped someone and they completely eliminated terminal cancer. And about 6 months later, they came back in and they said, I had something interesting happen. I said, what's that? I went back to my original oncologist who was treating me for over a year, surgery, radiation, and chemotherapy. And then when the cancer came back and they found that nothing more would work, and he said, well, at this point, try to get your life in order. You have a certain period of time to live. I think he said 2 to 3 months. And that's when he came to see me. And mind you, I almost never see anyone who's healthy. I see people in everything that orthodox medicine has to offer, and some of it works, and I support that. And a lot of it doesn't work, especially with chronic care, diabetes, arthritis, pain, fatigue, and aging. Fail miserably in that. So I work with him for over a year and develop a very specific protocol. And in time, his doctor said, well, this is good, whatever you're doing, but he didn't want to know what he was doing. Keep it doing it. And then he was cancer-free. And then he went back. The doctor went to see him in 6 months. Well, 6 months later, the doctor said, well, the reality is you probably just had a spontaneous remission. So that's normal. So I then said this. Ask your doctor, when was the last time he saw a spontaneous remission with one of his patients? When? Ask the people at Sloan Kettering. When did you have a terminal patient that you had been working with and given up on, and suddenly they had a spontaneous remission? Show me one. One single case in your entire history. They can't. Wow. So maybe we ought to have another area of healthcare called spontaneous remission possible, because these people just don't get it. There's one more reason why Wikipedia, in my opinion, is a fraud. It does not dispense information, but here is peer review literature of yoga and meditation improving mind-body, published in a highly respected journal of human neuroscience, investigating the effects of yoga and meditation on brain-derived neurotrophic factor. Now, that's hard objective data. It's not woo information. The activity on the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal affects and inflammatory markers. So by studying participants of an intensive 3-month yoga meditation retreat, the researchers found that the practices positively impacted the markers of the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal impact, the signaling, the cortisol awakening response, and immunological markers, in addition to improved subjective well-being. So I think that's really cool. Is this the only study that shows that yoga meditation? No, there are thousands of other studies. How's that possible? There'd be thousands of studies in the peer-reviewed literature, and yet your average physician's unaware of them and not able to suggest to their patients that these could be important in their life. After all, yoga practices consisting of physical postures and controlled breathing and seated meditation, during which the participants focused on mantra repetition and breathing and emptying the mind and bodily sensation, the researchers measured psychometric measures, brain-derived neurotrophic factor, and circadian salivary cortisol levels. And therefore, they had a strong anti-inflammatory response to cytokines, C-Y-T-O, cytokines, K-I-N-E-S. And so we can now say that mindfulness helps with depression and anxiety, and yoga helps with better breathing and more inhalation, air coming in, so you don't suffer from oxygen debt from being in a sedentary position. Plus, it helps the brain. So science is on your side. Good science. Quackery is on their side. It's just they control the media, so you're not always going to know this. But it's good for immunity, good for mood, good for stress, good for your metabolism, yoga and meditation. And that's important. Also, what is called astaxanthin, that's A-S-T-A-X-A-N-T-H-I-N, can protect skin health from within. This is a human data study, and what it is quite simply the supplementation with this antioxidant protects your skin from harmful effects of ultraviolet radiation. That's what is important there. It inhibits the production of inflammatory compounds from skin cells upon exposure to ultraviolet light, so you don't get the burn. You lessen the chance of having skin cancer. This was published in the Journal of Clinical Biochemistry and Nutrition. And finally, understanding how omega-3 dampens inflammatory reactions was this study from Norwegian University of Science and Technology. What do I mean? I mean that the omega-3 fatty acids, those are the good oils from avocado, walnut, flaxseed, or from fish, can help slow the development of diseases like cancer and Alzheimer's and multiple sclerosis. That's what the recent research has discovered. This is not the first research to determine that. And what it does, it dampens harmful inflammatory reactions in your body. and they studied macrophages isolated from mice and humans who found that the omega-3 fatty acids activated the autophagy and specifically affected some proteins that transformed the signals from the environment. So it's all good when it comes to these fatty acids. One quick last one from the University of Washington and the University College London. Antioxidant supplements is effective against degenerative eye disease. That's right. Zinc, copper, vitamin C, vitamin E, beta-carotene helps halt the progression of certain types of degenerative eye diseases. And it was published in the British Journal of Ophthalmology. So, think of those of you who've been using those antioxidants for all these decades, you've been listening to the show. You're on the right side of history. Vitamin C, vitamin E, beta-carotene, zinc, and copper can help with eye diseases. Now, we're going to take a brief break and come back, and I'm going to talk about the environmental issues, and then we're going to go to a commentary, then a break, and then we're going to have our guest on in about 20 minutes. But first, before we go to our break, something on the environment. Do you remember when I said that I sold my apartment in South Beach? It was right on the water on 2nd and Ocean Drive. A beautiful place. I bought it when it was run down. In fact, I remember as I was walking past 5th Street going south, a cop said, "Where are you going?" I said, "I'm walking down to look at some property." He said, "I wouldn't do that. It's after dark. This is a high crime area." So, all right, I didn't know the area, so I waited the next day, and I went down, and it was just all run down, but there was a billboard, and I saw a small building going to be built, and I thought, that looks good. So I went ahead and made a bid on it, and I was able to buy it, in part because I said I would do all the work on it myself. I'm very handy with doing design, architecture, work, building, and so I literally purchased just a concrete box. That's all it was. And then I went to decorate it, design it, and I ended up with one of the most beautiful apartments in all of Florida. And it turned out in the most perfect location because I had the entire top floor of a 9-floor building, and there was a park right across the street. All the other, like, 30 buildings and high-rises that are now, one faces the other, so nobody ever has a good view. And I lived there for 15 years. But then I started noticing the last year that I lived there that every day when I went for my 10-mile run on the beach, which was just, it was magical to run when it's quiet and you feel the breeze coming off. And I would notice how far the seaweed comes in. Remember, at night, you have high tide. With the tide comes in sea debris, like seaweed. And then in the morning, they come along with tractors before anyone gets out there, and they clean it all up. A very pristine beach. And for a whole year, every month, the seaweed came in further and further. And then one day I saw seaweed on the bottom of the furthermost swimming pools in the hotels. And that told me all these buildings from Key West clear up all of Florida, they're built on sand, not concrete. They have concrete stanchions going in and resting, but they're resting on sand. Well, just understand the physical dynamics. Water comes in at night, high tide, comes back out in the morning, and it's shifting the sand at the bottom. And then one day, you're going to have cracks in your walls. Then you're going to have an unstable building, and then you're going to have to fix it, which is very expensive or not possible, or you have to vacate it. So now, before I made my decision to sell that, I would go up Alton Road. South Beach is very skinny, like 8 blocks. And you walk over to Alton Road, which is closest to the bay. And then you walk up about 10 blocks, more or less, and you come to Lincoln Road, one of the most beautiful roads in America. It's really fun if you've never been to Lincoln Road. So and then I'd walk down there and look to see if there's anything in the concerts they would have, or the comedy clubs, or art movies. And just a wonderful place just to sit and people watch. It's fun. And I noticed Alton Road was flooded. I mean, really flooded. I thought that a water main break had broken. But every single night thereafter, the same water. And then I asked someone, because when I went to get in a cab to get up there, the water came right up to the bottom of the door. And the cab driver says, no, this is the new high tide. So the city invested hundreds of millions of dollars to get pumps to pump the water out of Alton Road back into the bay, which was right behind him. But, of course, the bay and the ocean are connected. Therefore, whatever you put into the bay is going to go right back around. It's like two people in a boat. There's a hole in the boat, so one person bails out the water and the other person bails it back in again. It makes no sense. Now they're saying that they have to build a road, probably 30 miles long at least, that's a mile or two back because and elevated about 3 to 6 feet because of flooding. So I did all the research. I looked at all of the science, and I filmed there for my new film on the environment. So I'm just going to tell you again, for those realtors and others saying, oh, you get great deals, look at how wonderful it is. Yeah, you might get some good deals, and yeah, it is a nice place, but it's not sustainable. And what's going to happen this year when you have a Category 5 possibly hitting you? They just missed a Category 5 last year. We got it on the other side. Everyone living on Southwest Florida got hit with Category 4, only 2 miles an hour under a Category 5. Did serious damage. Homes are still not repaired. If you're the average person, you'll still, if you're flying over, you see thousands of these blue tarps because people didn't get the money from their insurance companies. We all know how bad many insurance companies can be, especially giving you the full value of what was damaged, even though they expect the full amount of their premiums. So here's the latest to show you that if you wait too long, you will have waited beyond an opportunity to move. Quote, we should be retreating already from the coastline. Scientists suggest after finding warm waters below Greenland, and this is in EchoWatch. So Andrew Yang's assertion that people move away from the coast at the last Democratic debate is the completely rational and correct choice for NASA scientists in Greenland. Quote, there is enough ice in Greenland to raise the sea levels by 7.5 meters. By the way, that would be about 25 feet. An enormous volume of ice. And that would be devastating to coastlands all around the planet. Yes, it would be, but it's going to be especially damaging to people on the east coast from Florida clear up to Maine. Just want to let you know, that doesn't mean people have to rush out tomorrow, but it means that the future, and the future's rapidly approaching since the Arctic is melting and Alaska has already had all of its ice melt. We're not going to have much time for the future to make our move. All right, so I suggest that if you live in an earthquake fault, if you live in the forest near a lot of trees that are going to dry out and become fodder to burn down your houses, and thousands of homes were burned down last year in the United States and the out west, think again where else you could live that would still allow you quality of life, beauty of a greening environment, but safety. All right, just putting the information out. In a moment, Wikipedia, the fake encyclopedia. All right? So stay with us. We're going to take this on. Nice to have you with us, everyone. I'm Gary Null, and you can watch today's program by going to Progressive Radio Network Encyclopedia. And if you're looking, you're thinking, wow, Gary, you got a real short haircut. You have no idea. I decided to get a crew cut. And when they took, like, my hair was 7 inches long on top, and they started to cut it down, and then I started to realize, and they cut all around my ears here, and then I thought, hold on a second. I've got this three-month trial coming up of helping people. It's a pilot study of reversing the aging process. I'm going to be filming that whole thing. I don't want to be around the crew cut. I like the crew cut. I haven't had one since I was 18 years old because as much training as I'm doing now, I'm doing a lot of training for the World Games coming up in a year. I just don't like the long hair. It sweats. So you're saying almost a crew cut. That's why my hair is so short. In any case, I'm still looking for a personal assistant who would be working on a lot of different projects. And it's a full-time job. If that interests you, you can give us a call at 646-926-5459. Ask for Travis. And then if you have the qualifications, then I'll be seeing you for a personal interview. And hopefully, you'll be the person who can be in a wonderful, exciting environment where we're doing a lot of good. This article is now posted. Please share it with everyone. It is entitled Wikipedia, the Fake Encyclopedia by Richard Gale and myself. Efforts to gather and record world knowledge into a single self-contained resource has been a human endeavor for over 2,000 years. The oldest surviving encyclopedia was compiled by the Roman statesman Pliny the Elder during the first century of our common era and covered topics of natural history, architecture, medicine, and geography. Well, by definition, and similar to dictionaries, an authoritative encyclopedia is, quote, researched and written by well-educated, well-informed content experts, end quote. Encyclopedia entries on various topics are, quote, not written in order to convince, although one of its goals is indeed to convince its readers of its own veracity, end quote. In other words, the factuality of a topic is to be framed and understood within the culture and discipline or science on its own grounds. And for this reason, people prefer encyclopedias because of their reputation of objectivity, honesty, scholarship, and thoroughness. However, the words we just quoted are not found in a dictionary definition for an encyclopedia, nor in the Encyclopedia Britannica. No. Which, by the way, is correctly regarded as the world's most reliable qualified encyclopedia. Oddly, this is what one would read on Wikipedia's entry under Encyclopedia. And yet, the opening source encyclopedia frequently fails to meet this standard. Wikipedia holds the honor of being the most viewed and referenced encyclopedia in the world. The English Wikipedia now contains almost 6 million distinct entries that reach upwards of 500 million unique visitors every month. There are 32,000 health-related pages, and it's estimated that 84% of all medically related Google search queries display Wikipedia in the top 10 results. Now, although most medical entries do not draw controversy, and in fact provide relatively accurate and clear encyclopedic definitions on the biology and etiology of diseases and medical conditions, there is a small faction of approximately 700 pages that directly concern what we call complementary and alternative medicine, or CAM. CAM stands for complementary and alternative medicine therapies and natural health modalities. Body-mind, what I was just talking about earlier, yoga and meditation, chiropractic, acupuncture, and traditional Chinese medicine, naturopathy, homeopathy, orthomolecular medicine, and energy medicine. This grouping of articles has now been fractured off from the medical arts in its entirety and intentionally marginalized under the heading of pseudoscience and quackery, highly prejudiced and derogatory terms that do not belong in any legitimate encyclopedia. These are also the pages that have been hijacked by a movement of radicalized scientific rationalisms known as skepticism. Unlike other pages on medical science, there's an apparent lack of reputable medical professionals successfully editing these pages. The majority are anonymous amateurs who consistently rely on skeptic websites and publications as primary reference sources. Wikipedia skeptics make the claim that the information they provide about complementary and alternative medicine is supported by evidence-based medicine. Really? Well, we looked. This means there must be reliable scientific evidence that supports a medical intervention or treatment before it should be trusted. However, unlike the hard sciences of chemistry and physics, the practice of medicine and psychology and healing may best be understood as a healing arts rather than hard sciences that can reach a level of high factional certainty. We know far more about the activities of electrons and quanta than we do about the numerous biomolecular complexities in the human body. In fact, modern science barely knows anything about our day-to-day subjective experiences, and during dreaming sleep, there are over 200 modern scientific definitions for consciousness alone, ranging from theories that consciousness is not localized anywhere in the body, to the far extreme that there is no such thing as consciousness or conscious experience. Evidence-based medicine, therefore, is largely founded upon probabilities and rarely ever certainties. One of skepticism's consistent errors is to confuse the two, and this has led to skepticism's overarching prejudice for discounting complementary and alternative medicine, although it's called a pseudoscience. Well, it's not pseudoscience for all the people benefiting from all the practitioners using it, from all the 100,000 peer-reviewed articles in the government's own library of medicine. No, complementary and alternative therapies such as acupuncture, and traditional Chinese medicine, Indian Ayurvedic, homeopathy, hypnotism, mindfulness, these are examples of what they consider theories of modern medicine, and they're unable to measure and evaluate to determine their efficacy within their own limited theoretical parameters. Let me give you one example from real life. And this is the reality. Understand that reality always, always precedes scientific validation. And yet you would have the skeptics on Wikipedia believe that your experiences in life, your intuition, the power of your prayers, the ability to meditate, relax your heartbeat, these are all of no scientific principle. That's not true. I took 50 individuals who claimed they could heal. I put them into a study. We gave them mice that had ascites tumors. Of all 50, five of the individuals were able to repeatedly cure the mice. And we did it over a two-year period, six times. So that was by any measure one of the landmark principles of science. Can it be duplicated, replicated? And yes, it was. And then we found they could do a lot of other things. But then all the people involved had a background in the sciences or humanities. Rabbi Abraham Wiseman, Dr. Thomas Kruth, Dr. Dolores Krieger, the head of nursing at New York University, who founded Therapeutic Touch based upon that study that I created. So they have been given hard scientific and objective determinant insights that, yes, these things work. Now, why they work, that's your subjective input. But the fact that they do work, it's just like, look at all the people who have eaten the standard American diet, thinking they were getting all their vitamins and minerals from it. And look at those who didn't think they had to exercise. Now look at them and compare them to cross-match them with people their same age, same gender, who did the right exercising, and you'll see a huge difference in the two. Huge. And the older you get, the more pronounced that becomes. But did we know that we had the science on our side when we were talking about eating properly and having fiber? No, we didn't have all the science, but we had reality. And the reality of positive affirmation always precedes scientific validation. So for this reason, many serious scholars and researchers in a variety of fields ascertain Wikipedia's credibility is extremely low. A fundamental question is whether Wikipedia, as an open source platform that permits anyone who has the typing skills to create a pseudonym or false identity, to create or edit pages on any subject of their choosing, can properly be recognized as an authentic expert. No, not so. Has Wikipedia become a product of our post-truth virtual world where the distinction between facts and fiction intentional fabrications propaganda is dangerously blurred. Unlike other professional encyclopedias, such as the legitimate Encyclopedia Britannica, which relies strictly upon experts, scholars, and scientists recognized in their fields, a Wikipedia editor does not require any specific qualifications or training or educational background. A plumber can edit a page on neurosurgery, and a user will not know the better. Many page edits dealing with alternative medicine and parapsychology or body-mind medicine are regularly made by a portrait photographer at a California department store. Her accomplishments as a prolific Wikipedia editor has earned her celebrity status in the skeptic community. Although Wikipedia's policies state that editors must support their writing with reliable references, this is left to the discretion of the editor, and Wikipedia management has little to no oversight over this process. Ask anyone who's been libeled, shamed, slandered, and their reputations attacked on Wikipedia, and ask them, were they able to make any changes? The answer is no. That shows malice. That shows that there is a conspiracy to contain information on people. This entire purpose is to discourage anyone in believing in them. Furthermore, editors have their own biases towards what qualifies as an authoritative and reliable source. To elaborate upon the late astrophysicist Stephen Hawking's observation, quote, the skeptic's illusion of knowledge makes Wikipedia an enemy of knowledge. Wikipedia's editorial ambiguities and confusion are particularly acute when dealing with medical subjects. Consequently, for page entries concerning both conventional alternative medicine and health, Wikipedia has become a chaotic morass of poorly written articles plagued with rampant misinformation and out-and-out bias. Fortunately, we do not need to rely upon Wikipedia to access reliable information, especially regarding health medicine. Professor Ahmed Azam, a psychiatrist at the University of California at San Francisco, although supportive of Wikipedia's efforts, nevertheless recommends his patients visit government sites such as the National Library of Medicine, PubMed, and the National Alliance on Mental Illness for dependable health information. One trustworthy encyclopedia is the Encyclopedia Britannica, and unlike Wikipedia, Britannica's authors are never anonymous. Unlike Wikipedia, Britannica always seeks the best expert minds in the given field. Unlike Wikipedia, the Britannica takes full responsibility for the encyclopedia's content and review and vetting process for the next text being published. There's no room for private interest or biases or lying or individual ideologies or groups of dogmatists to take control and manipulate its content in order to advocate one perspective over another. The Britannica is absent of contributors who might be scientifically illiterate and yet act as authorities about the subject they have gained administrative control over. And unlike Wikipedia, Britannica relies upon highly reputable sources for referencing its content, ideologically based sources like Quackwatch and the Science-Based Medicine blog, and publications sponsored by skeptic organizations would never meet the Britannica's criteria for trustworthiness. And finally, unlike Wikipedia, Britannica takes the problem of research bias seriously and takes administrative steps to keep it out of the encyclopedia to the best of its capabilities. On the other hand, Wikipedia has created an environment that actually enables so-called volunteers to edit in a free-for-all power struggle and pay-to-play environment on behalf of private interests or public relations firms that include large corporations and foundations as their clients. Consequently, Wikipedia pages regarding fluoridation, genetically modified foods, pesticides, and vaccine safety, and alternative medical modalities that challenge pharmaceuticals' financial interests are especially flawed, misguided, and in some cases completely invalid. On Wikipedia's entries for these subjects, corporate-sponsored science is held in higher esteem than independent analysis and research. For subjects relating to complementary and alternative disciplines, Wikipedia is notoriously unreliable, and entries are written more as tabloid, cheap attack ads and gossip rather than objective descriptions of non-conventional therapies to educate the public in a manner that would enable a user to critically determine a subject's value for her or himself. The Encyclopedia Britannica, on the other hand, is far more objective and insightful in attempting to educate its users as to the reasons why a particular position should be taken. And Britannica observes a growing awareness of the limits of conventional medicine. That's its own words. And some believe that modern biomedicine has become counterproductive, also their words. So without condemnation, Britannica notes consumer demands for greater control over their own health, given the many tragedies from pharmaceutical medicine. But the Britannica shows no signs that it is promoting complementary alternative medicine outright. The encyclopedia clearly identifies some of the shortcomings, like lack of large randomized controlled trials, and the potential problem of positive outcomes being due to placebo effect. Moreover, while evidence-based medicine tends to disregard individual case studies in peer-reviewed literature, the Britannica acknowledges there exists, quote, a plethora of such studies, and collectively these should be regarded as producing, quote, positive qualitative outcomes. How about that? And finally, unlike Wikipedia and its founder Jimmy Wales' mission to hopefully discredit complementary alternative medicine therapies to the extent that they might be either federally banned or made unavailable to the public, the Britannica suggests that complementary and alternative medicine properly, quote, challenges some of the assumptions underpinning medical orthodoxy and questions the medical concept of disability. So, that's good. And several peer review analyses have concluded that Wikipedia's pages are poorly written and fraught with errors and biases. By the way, there was 97 Wikipedia articles were studied in one group by the University of Toronto School of Public Health, and they found that only 4% were assigned a good status. That means 96% of what was on Wikipedia on these topics was not of quality. So that's just one more issue that we have to address. It's not a real encyclopedia in our opinion. I'm Gary Null. We're going to take a brief break and come back in a moment with our guest. Please stay with us.
Feel that you can make it all alone. Remember, no one is big enough to go it alone. Just ask the lonely, they know the hurt and pain of losing a love. The young and foolish laugh at love.
I'd like to welcome all of you who are just joining us from around the world and all the syndicated stations carrying it. Thank you very much. And for the people who are listening, always share the information. Like the article I just wrote about Wikipedia and its lack of objectivity, how we believe it's not a legitimate encyclopedia like Encyclopedia Britannica and seven others, that only works if you, in turn, are able to share that information. Right now, we're going to our conference phone where Dr. Beverly Rubik, R-U-B-I-K, is standing by to talk about the dangers of 5G rollout and the adverse effects of wireless electromagnetic frequencies on human anatomy and health. She is a renowned biophysicist investigating the role of consciousness in the physical world and complementary and alternative medicine, particularly the role of the human biofield. She's currently the founder of the Institute for Frontier Science, and they're out in California, Emeryville, California. And she was the director for the Center for Frontier and Science at Temple University and was a congressionally appointed member of the National Institutes of Health Advisory Board for the Office of Alternative Medicine. And she has also done a lot of work on the term biofield, and it was accepted into the National Library of Medicine. And she serves on the editorial boards of the Journal of Alternative and Complementary Medicine. Nice to have you with us today.
Thank you. I'm delighted.
You're just back, and we'd like to hear about your trip. And during the past year, we have been covering the human and environmental health risks associated with wireless EMF radiation and the new 5G technology. And several of the important critics of 5G, including Dr. Deborah Davis, have been on recently to share their warnings. However, given your unique area of specialization in the human biofield, you can provide another dimension of expertise into how 5G rollout will further endanger our health, because these smaller wireless antennas will be everywhere and nobody will be able to escape them. China is currently far ahead of the United States with its 5G rollout, and you've made a couple of trips recently to Hong Kong and the mainland. So I'd like to begin with you sharing what is now being observed in China now that several cities have completely employed 5G and these cities' citizens are exposed to 5G wireless. The forum is yours.
Yes. Well, first of all, the Chinese people are using their cell phones much more than Americans, if you can imagine. It's practically continuous use. They often attach their cell phone to a special phone wire on their body. So their major organs are exposed 24/7 to their cell phones. And they do everything from shopping on their cell phone. It's a cashless society, identified with a QC code, which looks like a barcode. Everybody's got a code, their social score, their, of course, texting, their vocal calls, etc. So they're on those phones much more than most. What I've heard about, and I wasn't in Shenzhen, but that's where the 5G rollout has happened already. That's also the home of Huawei, which is the Chinese large telecom company that has been very successful in making phones and putting out 5G. And I've heard that people are already getting sick, that young people, too, are not feeling well. I've heard the same coming out of regions of London where people are exposed to 5G, and also Sacramento, California, where there's been some experimental rollouts. So from three separate sources, young and old have reported that they're not feeling well. They're feeling sick, like flu-like symptoms with 5G.
The government and private industry, along with the mainstream media, notably the New York Times, which has the most to gain from 5G through its collaboration with Verizon, tell us that 5G frequencies are safer than the current fourth and third generations that we currently rely upon. Why shouldn't we believe this, and in what ways has 5G been shown to be a greater health risk? And since your area of specialization is biofields, is there any compelling research on electromagnetic frequencies' effects upon the biofield that gives cause for concern?
Well, first of all, there's a large body of literature. It's really thousands of papers that have been published since the discovery of radio waves decades ago. Radio sickness has been long known. And, of course, some of these waves of 5G have been used by radar, by the military, and even a weapon system. 95 gigahertz is used in the active denial weapon system to dispel crowds because it burns the skin. And all of this is in the literature. And 5G is much more complex than earlier generations. It's some nine bands of frequencies that span from microwaves, the lower range, which is similar to 4G, up to the millimeter range of waves. And we know from the literature that these waves cause more dire consequences. They're closer to natural processes in the body, so they're going to play havoc with natural systems. The biofield is the organizing field of the body that I believe controls all of the physiology and biochemistry. And so if we start blasting us with waves in that dimension, then we actually interfere with physiological and biochemical processes across the board, broadly in our biological system. I've measured the biofield, and I can see the disruption in it from 4G. We don't have 5G yet where I live, but we can see disruptions, a shrinking biofield, an asymmetrical biofield, as a result of exposure to wireless communication devices.
When Dr. Deborah Davis was on the program a couple of months ago, she spoke at length about 5G's effects on reproductive health, and particularly men's sperm quality. And I noted in your research paper on short-term mobile phone effects on blood cells that there is evidence that electromagnetic frequencies adversely affect stem cells and enzyme activities, both of which are critical for premature aging. What does the science show regarding wireless effects on stem cells and enzymes?
Well, effects on stem cells, I actually haven't measured. I was looking at the blood. Enzyme activity is thwarted by these waves, and of course, that's totally disruptive then to the biochemistry, which is a delicate balance of sequential enzyme reactions.
Well, 5G propaganda touts the benefits this technology will have on average citizens' life. However, it's clear that such an enormous and expensive undertaking, which intended to have global reach, is not being launched just so we can download films from Netflix faster or turn our different computers on and our cell phones to get a faster response. This is far more benefits for the nation's military and defenses and national security and surveillance and law enforcement. Can you speak on how these federal and private industries will welcome and benefit most from 5G?
Well, of course, because we're going to be completely surveilled, every aspect of our life. And if we thought advertising was targeted now, it will be super targeted after they know every tiny habit and usage of the Internet of Things, which, of course, 5G is all about. So this is the advancement of technocracy, of the utter use of technology to surveil and control our lives. And it's very disturbing, really. It's not about faster downloads. That's just the sales pitch to some of us who fall for it, but it's quite dire, I think, and people should be quite wary about it.
We're going to be doing a special program on Tuesday evening on the Progressive Commentary Hour with a person who was in Google's high area for years and then quit, and he's going to be telling us how much Google has aligned itself with the private military industrial complex, the Pentagon, spy agencies, DARPA. So you're right on that. My final question is, one of the most important areas that we're not talking about is, what if we're living in a city or town where 5G is fully installed? Is it possible to mitigate our exposure in order to be more safe from electromagnetic frequency adverse impacts?
Well, there's a range of protective technologies, from paint for your exterior or interior walls, to clothing, to tents of electromagnetic shielding that are fine netting that people can use. I'm hopeful that there may also be white zones. I know Hawaii is doing some of these that are electromagnetically free of Wi-Fi, and I hope that other cities will do the same, that will consider white zones, because not all of us can take these fields. There are certainly electrosensitive people, and we can expect more electrosensitivity because the dosage affects us. It's cumulative, and we can expect more people getting sick.
We're going to keep on top of this. In fact, we're doing a new documentary on the very topic. Beverly, thank you very much. I appreciate coming on our show today.
You're welcome. Thank you, Gary.
From Emeryville, California, Dr. Beverly Rubick. And her foundation is frontiersciences.org. And also brubik, RUBIK.com, brubik or frontiersciences.org. Now, just as a way to closing up the program, I want to share something. I was working today, and by the way, we're up to date, I'm told, with all the people who have ordered anything. It's all being sent out today. That's good. And so we want to offer a special. We have now offered a special in a month. Here is the special. We don't have a lot of them, so while they last, the Supreme Health Formula. Now, the Supreme Health Formula is where I decided to put everything that a person would benefit from on a day-to-day basis, so you didn't have to buy $485 worth of separate 30-day supply of nutrients. And, of course, I put the protocol together based upon what I know the good science is. So, for example, I'm just reading off a label here. You're going to get the biotin, pantothenic acid, at 500 milligrams, by the way, and iodine, magnesium, 800 milligrams of magnesium, you're getting zinc and manganese, quercetin, selenium, molybdenum, potassium, and then superstars, alpha-lipoic acid. And we're talking 150 milligrams. That's a big dose, but I feel people need it. Trimethylglycine, phosphatidylserine, soy isoflavone, inositol, lutein, citrus bioflavonoids, L-taurine, N-acetylcysteine, L-lysine, ornithine, alpha-ketoglucarate, choline bitartrate, phosphatidylcholine, acetyl-L-carnitine, bromelain, ginger, DHA, glutamine, hesperidin, acerola, broccoli, ginkgo, quercetin, coenzyme Q10, grapeseed extract, lycopene, bilberry extract, milk thistle, mushroom complex, pyrimidine and benzoic acid, plus vitamin C and all the other nutrients. I mean, no one's ever done anything like that ever. This is the first time. And it's a big bottle. In fact, right here it is. So if you're looking, that's how big the bottle is. And this is the tablets. You're getting 300 tablets. And what we suggest is this. There's a strong smell to it because it's got the sulfur in it. And the sulfur is very powerful in your body, absolutely necessary. You throw it into a blender. That's the best way of taking it. I suggest you put like 5 tablets in, put a banana, your protein, and drink this in a shake in the morning. Then you can have more you could do later in the day. So we priced it out, and we only have, and this is it, when this is gone, it's gone forever. But anyhow, this was reduced in price. You're not paying $485. You're paying, I believe it was $145. Plus, we're adding 2 videos in, and these 2 videos are power aging and how to live forever. So you add up what you're getting, and you're getting a $234.98 value, $234. Your cost is $99. That's it. That's a huge discount from $235 to $99. Now, I'm going to give you a number that you're going to call in. Our number is 877-627-5065. Again, to order this special, this is the best I can do, Supreme Health Formula. It's got everything in it. And as far as supplements, plus you're getting 2 really good videos that you'll want to watch and watch and watch because it's packed with information. You're getting it all for $99. If you bought it individually, you're going to spend $235. So you're saving $135. Call 877-627-5065. 877-627-5065. We're out of time, everyone. Tomorrow, another commentary challenging Wikipedia, and this one's completely different. This one, we're going to look at what kind of person would attack people who've made it a better world and feel they can do this with impunity, and they're anonymous, and there's thousands of them. I mean, who does this? Who is not ever held accountable for their actions, the bullying, the harassment? What kind of person? We're going to go into the mental health of some of these Wikipedia editors on tomorrow's commentary. It's all done. We're just waiting. The other one on Wikipedia you can download. And don't forget my webinars. I've got 9 available up there right now. Adding 30 years to your lifespan, reversing brain aging, vaccines, are they safe? Are they effective? Should they be mandatory? It's not your fault you're fat, no more menopause, how to live forever, the healing touch, how to survive any disaster, and the big 3, diabetes, heart disease, and obesity. So these are available now. Take a look. All right? Nice to be with you today, everyone, and have a nice day.